Welcome to What Drives You with your host, Mike Gorday. Human Solution Consultant from Seattle, Washington. It is now time to sit back, buckle up for the show that drives the asking question of what drives you. And now your host, Mike Gorday.
And welcome to this week's episode of What Drives You, the show about why we do the things we do. Today, we're going to be talking with Mona Nyree, who is going to talk a little bit about her struggles with generational trauma. So I will warn you up front, we're going to be talking about some things that people might find a little uncomfortable, one of those being trauma, and another, we're going to talk a little bit about suicide. Then we're going to move on to the topic of the day, which is going to be trauma. And then the question of the day. So stick around. We'll be right back with the interview. Thank you. And welcome back. Today we're being joined by Mona Nyree from my home state of Prescott, Arizona. Hi, Mona. How are you?
Doing great. How are you, Mike?
I am doing well, even though it's raining here and it's probably not there.
No, it's 73 degrees and beautiful.
Yes, I know. I missed that. So, Mona, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Your show. Go ahead.
Well, like Mike said, my name is Mona. I'm originally from Pennsylvania, so I'm not technically from your home state. I've been out here for about 3 years now. Since I graduated college, I moved out to Arizona just because I had some opportunities to, through AmeriCorps, work with different nonprofits, and then ended up getting hired at one, staying out here, and just loving life, trying to fulfill a mission. And I recently became like a step parent, so I'm navigating those waters as well.
Fun.
Yeah, definitely an exciting experience to learn a lot.
All right, that's great. So you mentioned mission. What is your mission?
My mission is to help people free themselves from the shackles of generational trauma and just their own upbringing, all their programming, and to live a life that actually brings them joy, where they like getting up, whether or not they're rich or not, they're rich in soul. Mm-hmm. That's my mission.
Okay, so I know what you're talking about, but for the sake of our audience here, what are you talking about when you say generational trauma?
Generational trauma is, and I'm not going to be the best person to tell you the exact Webster dictionary version.
That's okay.
But the layman term definition is just cycles of trauma and behaviors and ways of being that stem from either in a society or in a family generations back that continue. That it's something that just becomes normal. So the way I like to see it is there's this experiment where scientists put fleas inside of like a little cage, and naturally the fleas want to jump out. So they put a lid on it. And after a while, these fleas learn not to jump out of the cage. And they saw generations later, like fleas reproduce pretty fast, generations later, it is in their DNA not to jump, to the fact that they can take the lid off and those fleas, even though they have not been the ones conditioned to do the behavior or not to do the behavior, they're not jumping, they're trained. Mm-hmm. So it's just like, if you take that and you look at it, okay, what things happened in society? What things just happened in my family? What things happened in this community that my family has lived in for a while? And you kind of see how things shape what the norm is, that you don't even know that could be shackles and holding back from living your true expression and jumping out of that cage.
Okay, and it's your mission to try and bring some education around this and help people get out of that.
100%.
100%, okay. What do you think drives that?
realizing my own generational, what I like to call shackles, that I didn't even know were there from the way I was conditioned, like school growing up, but kind of even looking back and seeing what my family had been through, and that, oh, being attracted to people who are toxic and abusive, that is not just me, that's like my mom, my mom's mom. It's just like you go back and back and back, and you see it's just a pattern of women who have low self-worth, and that they surrender and they numb themselves with drugs. Or seeing the anger that my dad had, that his dad had, just going back, all these things that were affecting me, and the depression that wasn't dealt with or talked to. And it came to, I didn't realize this like one day. I didn't just wake up and was like, whoa, I have generational trauma. Mm-hmm. What really happened is, growing up, my life was, it was all right. It wasn't that best, but there was a lot of things that made me feel small and not wanted. And I was bullied a lot. And my dad was a huge bully. And, disciplinarian, on like the borderline of maybe this was abusive. Mm-hmm. Like I remember before school, he told me all about what foster care was and how not to tell, if I tell what was happening behind closed doors, that they would take me away and he would not be able to get me back. And my half brothers and sisters had been taken away from my biological mom. So he explained to me what they went through. And I don't remember much about being five, but I remember that specific conversation. Story, huh? Yeah, I remember being scared that I didn't want to do that. And they were, both my parents were drug addicts growing up. So it's just that combination. And at 13 years old, my mom dying, really, she was the only person I felt like cared about me in my life. It really rocked my world and turned me into this person who stuffed it. Well, I already was stuffing emotions. Mm-hmm. I had my first suicidal thought at 9 years old, but 13 is when my mom passed away. I started experimenting with drugs, went to juvenile hall, like just started self-mutilating, like burning myself, all these things. And that continued. And I found myself at this state with living with my dad. We moved to a new place because he had lost ours, and we're living with this woman that was absolutely jealous of me, and I found out later she was a drug addict as well. But I left home at 17 and I moved in with a boyfriend who was my first physically abusive relationship. And I thought, okay, this is terrible. I reached out to my sister, she came to get me. And then she she encouraged me to go to college. And a couple months later, she says, I'm pregnant with this guy I met, and I don't know what you're going to do. We're going to go move in with him. And her and my nieces and nephews left, and I had no one. And it was just that year of bouncing back and forth from house to house, like having a P.O. box because I didn't have a stable address for a year. I was basically homeless. And meeting somebody that I thought was the best thing ever. And at this time, my dad was waiting for a settlement to come in, and he had promised me we'd have a better life. So I kept holding on to that. Meanwhile, these thoughts from 9 years old of I want to kill myself were ratcheting up in their loudness inside of my head. Mm-hmm. And I was just in a dark haze, but here comes this man in shiny armor. So I move in with him, and it turns out to be a worse relationships in the first physically abusive relationship that I left, and he was an alcoholic and all these things, which, like I said, plays into generational traumas and things that were in my family.
Right. You're following patterns.
Yeah. And at one point my dad calls me, and I think he'd tell me that we're moving, and I thought my life was gonna get better, but that phone call did not go that way.
Right.
It was basically like, I'm going to give you money to fix your crappy car, because I had a really, really crappy car. And I don't have a daughter anymore. Like, all you do is you use me. And that's all I felt like at that moment, was that people used me and that I was like a huge burden, that unless somebody wanted something, that was like my only worth.
Mm-hmm.
So for him to say that, it really dug deep. I mean, everything was a sting, but that dug so deep in my soul. And he hung up, and I was outside that night. I would never forget that night. I was sitting in my Mercury Cougar. It's dark outside. My ex worked at a bar, so he had just left for work. That's why I went outside to talk in the car, so that way while he was getting ready, he wouldn't hear whatever good news I was about to get, because I thought this was my ticket out, and it wasn't. And I will never forget looking out the window in my Mercury Cougar. It was just the darkest night, like so dark. It might have been cloudy. I don't know. I just remember there were no stars in the sky. And I felt like that was me. Like I was the only person in a sea of darkness. And I decided in that moment, like, why do I keep trying to live when life feels like I'm hanging on by my fingertips? And it has felt that way pretty much since 9 years old, but it intensified after my mom passed away. So I went back in there. I was gung-ho on I was gonna kill myself. And generational traumas or just generational patterns would say, you know, don't talk about your business, don't talk about that. And we were really good at facing being a good public face,
right?
So I didn't want anybody to know what I was going through, because I was really good at hiding all of my stuff. And in the process, I had isolated myself more and more because it was getting harder to hide everything that was going on. So I was like, I need to look up how I'm going to do this. I don't have fun. I need to look up how I'm going to do this and actually follow through, commit, and wake up wherever the heck is the afterlife. Like, I just need to make sure it works. So I went online and I found some, I don't even know what it was, maybe a dark Reddit or subreddit, something. And I'm looking, how do you kill yourself? And here's this form of people talking about the different ways they've tried. Like, drinking bleach on its own doesn't kill you. I didn't know that until I read that. And you would think that it does. And they were saying different ways that they've tried to kill themselves and how you could tweak it. But what I noticed on there was that people were telling their stories and saying to the person above them on the thread or below them, however that works, is that, no, you don't deserve to die. Like, you have potential to make your life better, but here's exactly why I do.
Yeah.
And I just read heartbreaking story after heartbreaking story after heartbreaking story. And in that moment, for the first time, and I would say since my mom died, my heart broke open for somebody else's story other than my own. And I realized, comparing my life to those people, like, yeah, it was bad, but it was not that level bad. It was not that level of abuse. It was not that level of evil, like, of in darkness and depression. And I just thought for them, like, okay. And it started off like this, like, okay, I'm gonna figure out how to not survive life, like, not feel like I'm living life hanging on by my fingertips and they're like ripping off,
right?
I'm going to figure out how to enjoy life, how to thrive life, and then I'm going to come back and I'm going to show them how to get out of the darkness and into a light that's not just surviving. Like, you can keep living, like, you can do this. That's really like this is how, this is the evolution out of that darkness into the light. And it was like, and then I was like, and once I do that, then I'm going to kill myself. But now I love life. And I want to give people that same opportunity, just to love and to figure and unlock themselves. Because I didn't know, like, when that moment happened, I didn't know the journey I was going to go on for the next 7 years. I didn't know the depths of myself I was going to uncover and be able to trace back and all these things. I didn't know what I didn't know, but now I do. And I am 100% here to do that. I mean, that moment is, I wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for that moment. So to not do that does that moment and my life's purpose injustice. So that's what kind of motivates and drives that mission.
Okay. You said 7 years. Is that how long it took you to get to this spot where you want to keep living and that you're enjoying life? Or is that something else?
I No, I would say it took me that long. It probably took 3 years because I didn't go to therapy. That was like another thing that my family was big on was you don't talk to people about your problems. So, and my dad would say it's like a voodoo science, even though now I'm like, no, if I have issues, I'm gonna instead of waiting and working through this one, I'm gonna go get a therapist. But yeah, it took about 3 years for me to get out of the depression and then to really get my mindset, like a constant depression, because that's what I was in a constant depression where I constantly numb with different drugs and people and things like that. But then another 4 years to really get to a spot where I woke up and I realized I'm the person that I really want to be. So last year is when that happened. I realized, whew, I'm the person that 19-year-old me wanted to be. And then the last year, just been trying to figure out, okay, well, what did I exactly do, and how can I help people, and do the mission part, because cleared the shackle part.
So you are now working. Tell me a little bit about the story of where you're working and how you're feeling about it and going to your boss. Tell me about that story.
Okay, so right now I'm working for AmeriCorps, which is cool because I was an AmeriCorps member when I came before I got hired on with that nonprofit. And just in August, I left my nonprofit because I had this shake. Like, if you shook up a soda can and it's all this pressure, like waiting to explode, that's how I felt. Like, even though I was doing meaningful work helping kids in foster care, I felt like this is not what I'm meant to do, so I need to leave and go do my thing. So I applied for AmeriCorps, I got that position, and that feeling did not go away. And I realized that feeling was me wanting to figure out a way to like take my mission, my life's purpose, and put it out there to help people. So that way, that's what I'm doing. And so my performance, I mean, I'm pretty good at marketing and I'm good at fundraising and all these things that are parts of the job that I do here at AmeriCorps. But my boss knows me because she was actually the person who got me to come from Pennsylvania in AmeriCorps. So she knows who I am and she's like, Mona, you're not giving your 100%. And I'm like, because Annie, I don't feel like I want to be here. And the conversation really came up because I wasn't given my 100%. I have an opportunity to get a master's degree for free. And I'm like, I don't want that. Like, I need to leave. So like in the next year, I'm gonna be out. So I just want to get you guys in a good position and I want to fight this. And she was like, Mona, you don't have to fight anything. What's your mission? What's your dream? So I explained to her what I want to do, and I explained to her I'm just not sure how, and I put out all these different ways that I think that it could manifest and be real. And she's like, okay, why don't we incorporate that into what you do here at AmeriCorps? If that's going to give us 100% Mona, then let's do it. And I'm like, how? How are we going to do this? And she came up with, okay, well, what do you have right now? What is this that you want to teach people? Why don't we, because we have personal and professional development for all of our AmeriCorps members, which is over 40 right now. Why don't we make it something that they get, which is like their professional development credits? They can do a lot. They have to get a certain amount of hours in their service time to get this certification that we have for them. So it's like pretty much mandatory, but they can pick and choose what kind of things they want to learn. Why don't we create something? So on December 10th, I have something created. And then she was like, and you know what? Why don't we try to take this thing? Because I really want to help kids like teenagers, because my teenage years were the hell were the hell that brought me to my breaking point. She was like, why don't we reach out to the teen center and see if we could do a series or a workshop day with them and teach them that and some of our other nonprofits that we work with, and get that in there. And then you know what? why don't next year, so it's an incentive to stay here, we incorporate it into not just a small little class that I could do for like 2 hours, but something that I could break down into a series that our members can take. And if that goes very well and you get good feedback from that, we can make that be something that people can take at college for credits, because she did the same thing with this thing that she calls civic leadership training. Uh-huh. And that's actually the certification people get. So she's like, and then what you're teaching can be accredited, because she said it's not just for people in hard places. What this is, it's for everybody. And I'm like, wow, okay, yeah, let's do that. And that made me motivated to stay in this position, because now when I'm working on things, I can spend half of my work time working on the thing that I really, the reason I'm here, and get paid to do it. Wow.
Talk about an interesting twist, right? You know, we talk about, you were talking about how generational things work and what you kind of expect from other people. And here you run into an unusual boss who, instead of like normal, you would expect him to go, okay, well, see you later. Actually,
yeah,
supports
that's what
you,
I thought.
Right? How interesting, yeah, is that?
It's pretty great. It tells me I'm on the right path for sure.
Good, good. And where are you in this process of creating this program?
Before I even brought it up to her, I had created a 3-month program that I've taken 2 people through. Mm-hmm. Already, but that was more like a coaching type thing. And in doing that, I realized I didn't want to do like one-on-one coaching. So I was trying to figure out how to change that and how to work with that in something different. So I have everything I need to create the curriculum. I just need to now translate it from a coaching to a teaching, which is great, because I had the goal of creating a course that I could sell, and then creating like a support group that goes along with that course that they could get group coaching in. Mm-hmm. So it's forcing me to do that so that way I can make sure I have everything rock solid for next year when I launch it here with Arizona Serve.
Wow. Talk about some exciting news, right?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
All right. Well, I certainly appreciate you sharing that. That's a lot of deep stuff that you have shared with us today. And, you know, I commend you for that. We're about out of time, unfortunately, for the segment. Is there any last thoughts that you might want to put out there?
The only thing is, if you're in a dark space, realize that you're the light at the end of the tunnel. And there might be people that can help you get there, but the light, changing your mindset and changing your behaviors and breaking your generational shackles.
Okay. Well, thank you for that. So that's going to do it for us right now. I hope you will come back and join us for our next segment. Thanks again, Mona, for sharing your story with us and talking about what drives you. Have a great day, and we'll see you later. And thanks again for sticking with us. I hope you enjoyed the talk with Mona. I know that might be a little bit hard for some people to hear. We're going to talk a little bit about trauma today, because that seems kind of an appropriate thing. And since I'm finished with the basic layering of human behavior, we need to move on to some other topics. So for those of you who might not understand what trauma is, basically it's a shock to the system, whether it's a bodily wound or a psychological wound. In a general sense, life is full of these. And from a psych field, from the field of psychology, we can classify these into two things, the big T traumas and little T traumas. Little T trauma is something that is, well, fairly new in the realm, that people really didn't take a lot of it. People didn't really pay a lot of attention to it several years ago. And it comes along with our understanding of what PTSD is and things of this nature. So what do I mean by a big T trauma? Big T trauma is something that is a large shock to the system. It could be a car accident. It could be a near drowning. It could be a mugging, anything like that. Little T traumas are smaller shocks that, let's say, maybe it's a fender bender, or maybe it's not a mugging, but it's getting frightened that somebody frightens you. So and the reason why we talk about little T and big T is significant, because big T traumas can really affect our nervous system in a very big way. Little T traumas are usually easier to recover from a lot faster. But if we have a series of little T traumas, we can then create a big T system out of that. What I mean by that is that anything that we sustain over a period of time can be considered traumatic. And what happens with the human psyche is that when we sustain these, we develop responses in order to get us through that event and help us survive after. So it again, and we're always coming back. We seem to be always coming back to this survival response. And that's what I'm talking about. If you watch the, or you've watched there and listened to the interview, you will hear her talk about generational trauma. Generational trauma is trauma that passes from mother to, or from parent to child to grandchild, because it's literally changes our DNA. So it can be physically passed on to our children. If we suffer from depression, there's a genetic component that says that my children are going to suffer from depression. Maybe not going, but they're at risk. They're at risk of suffering from depression. So that's what that generation, and oftentimes generational trauma is socialized. So it gets another whammy. So we have a lot of things going on. What happens in the psych realm is that if you have suffered a trauma in your past, whether that's a quick big T trauma like you were in a car accident, or it's a sustained big T trauma like you were neglected as a child or abused as a child, you develop certain activities that keep you, or that attempt to keep you safe from those traumas happening again. And I call them trauma templates. You know, so if you've had a car accident, you might be aware that the first few months after a car accident, it's very difficult to get back into a car and drive. And we have what's called hypervigilance. We're really paying attention to what's going on. And if something happens that looks like or resembles what happened when we had that car accident, we immediately go into panic mode. And it can be a little difficult for us, because it can actually recreate an accident because we overcorrect or slam on the brakes or something. So it's kind of like this program that gets inserted into your system that hyperactivates your survival mechanisms in your brain. And as you remember, when our survival brain activates, it supersedes our ability to use our executive functioning or our judgment. And in the case of a trauma event, that happens a lot faster. I mean, it happens so quick, you don't even know it's coming. If you've been in a car accident, you know what I mean. I've been in a car accident, so I can tell you with certainty that it's very difficult to get back in the car and continue to drive after that accident, because you are so, you're very careful. You're so careful that you can almost feel things happening around you. It's kind of a very strange thing. And when we sustain these types of trauma a lot, this is where we develop things like PTSD. Your body remembers. Your physiology stores this information, not just in the brain, but in your body. And it can be a very difficult thing to address. And a lot of times we're often unconscious of it being there. So what happens when we've had a trauma in our childhood that we've had to create survival skills around, is that something can happen in our adult life that reminds us of that trauma in our childhood, and immediately the survival response rears up. And we're suddenly in survival mode, and we're trying to deal with that situation as we thought we were supposed to deal with it as a child, because we're trying not to relive that trauma. So we start doing things that could be considered crazy or aggressive or frightening. And there's some studies that you might want to take. One is called early childhood trauma. That is a study that was, I can't remember when it was done, but it first started off as a weight loss study. And then they found some correlating evidence from early childhood trauma. And then we have what's called trauma-informed care, which is a quasi-therapeutic model for service-oriented people. And the idea is this, is that you really have to look at people's behavior with the idea that they may be doing something as a result of some unconscious trauma. And if we can do that, if we can look at this, if we can look at some aggressive behavior, we can look at anger or crying in inappropriate times or whatever it is. If we can look at that and we can see that there is some possible trauma there that this person may not even be aware of, that gives us another tool to let us step back and understand a little bit more, a little better about what's going on. And then we can choose the way we're going to deal with this situation. So this is a great thing that is really useful for people in service industries, especially in social service realms, where you tend to find a lot of concentrated behavioral issues, like very angry people, people who are mentally ill, people who have what we consider what is considered inappropriate behavior. It's very functional for this type of training in these situations, because it's one more piece. It's one more piece to understanding human behavior. And that's one of the reasons why I'm talking about it today as well. Because realistically, every single one of us has at some point experienced some form of trauma. It may not be a big T trauma, but we have definitely experienced some small T traumas in our life. And when we encounter those, that's the amazing, well, maybe that's not amazing, but that's one of the things the brain does so well, is remember these events. Now, our brain remembers, we don't. but it's the unconscious that creates this memory that is stored in the body. So anytime that I'm running around and I see something that reminds me of some trauma that I experienced as a child, or that I've forgotten about, or I thought I may have fixed in the past, my brain remembers. And if I'm not paying attention, my brain takes over and I start doing things that may not be appropriate in this situation. You know, this is one reason why we have a lot of conversations around being triggered these days, why we have a lot of conversations about safe places and things like that, is people reacting emotionally to certain stimulus, possibly because there is trauma there. So we're not going to talk too much about that. I just wanted to kind of go a little bit further with that today because of the interview, and really encourage you to think about this as a person, not only somebody who may have had trauma, but as a person who could be seeing it in somebody else's behavior. It's just one more way of distancing yourself so that you can choose a different way of looking at things. Again, if you have any questions, let me know. I'm happy to have conversations with you offline, but we're going to move on. So stick around. We're going to get with our question of the day, and you probably won't be surprised. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. And welcome back. Okay, so this is a little bit, maybe this is a little lighter, but I've been asked this question several times this week. Why toilet paper? Why toilet paper? And you probably already know what I'm talking about because it's happening all over again. We've got stuff going on, COVID spikes. We've got governments clamping down. The first thing that's out in the stores is toilet paper. And the question is, why? Why are people hoarding toilet paper? It seems like a very strange, odd behavior. But if you think about it, or if you look at it, it really isn't. It's based on a cognitive bias called zero risk bias. And this is where in cases of uncertainty and complex issues, we will default to an issue that we can solve very easily, and it gives us comfort. So if you saw the very first show, I talked about the crazy stuff that we're seeing during this COVID year, and talked a little bit about why we're seeing these kind of things. And this is the same thing. People start to panic, whether they realize it or not, they're panicking. And they feel like they need to get something that's very easy to control. And actually, toilet paper is one of them. Now, I have some reasons why this may be. These are just opinions based on what I think about human behavior and social things. But in our modern culture, whether we want to admit it or not, we design our lives around the bathroom. I know that may feel uncomfortable for some of you, but it's kind of true if you think about it. Our lives are designed around a bathroom. We get up, the first thing we do in the morning is go to the bathroom. We often spend a lot of time in the bathroom doing our preening and brushing our teeth and washing our hair, taking baths, taking care of ourselves. When we go out, we always want to locate bathrooms. there's bathrooms in every restaurant that we go into. If there's not, there's somebody who knows where the closest bathroom is. We have, and not on top of that, we have a lot of social ambiguity around what that should look like. Meaning it's a point of vulnerability for us. And our culture, and as most cultures are, we tend to hide our vulnerabilities. So bathroom is a place where we're most, where we're very, very vulnerable. So we have a lot of rules around bathroom etiquette. We have rules around talking about it. We have rules around thinking about it and portraying it in certain activities. So what does this got to do with toilet paper? Well, there's a direct connection between this sort of suppressed ideology, if you will, of our bathroom vulnerability and what's going on out in the world. It's an easy fix. For one, toilet paper is non-perishable. It's not going to go anywhere. It's not like food or liquid drinks or anything like that. It's non-perishable. Also, it takes up a lot of space, which I don't have any proof of this, but this is something that I think. It takes up space, so it makes things look better for us. We look in our closet full of those toilet paper rolls and we can go, we can relax. Because how many times have you needed toilet paper and it wasn't there? And that's a third reason. So something that seems very innocuous and odd, doesn't that make more sense now? Why we see this happening over and over again? Why toilet paper? This is the same thing we're doing with cleaning supplies and everything like that. That's a more direct result, but the toilet paper has always been the odd one, is the toilet paper. So there you go. That's my thoughts on the toilet paper. I hope that makes things a little bit easier when you do go to the store and it's not there. Probably not by much, because we all need the toilet paper. So if you have any more questions, please submit them at mike@whatdrivesyou.net. I'm happy to put your question on the air. I'll give credit to that question of the day to Connie, who was the first one who asked me about that this past week. But I've gotten that question 3 or 4 times. So again, if you have any questions, mike@whatdrivesyou.net. Have a great day. Look forward to seeing you again next week. Bye-bye.